there was a time when everybody got their tonsils out just because you had them, you know, back in like the 60s and 70s. And then there was a time period when nobody took the tonsils out. And now we're kind of coming back to a place where many people need to have their tonsils out, but not everybody. And so the question is, well, why do we even worry about tonsils? Why do we talk about them? Why are they interesting? A lot of people come in to me saying, I didn't know that you could still get your tonsils out. You know, I've been sick forever. And then we kind of get down to, well, what does forever mean? There is a recommendation that goes like this. If you've had 7 episodes of tonsillitis in a year, you probably ought to think about getting your tonsils out. Or 5 tonsil infections a year for 2 years in a row. Or 3 tonsil infections a year for 3 years or longer. Getting the tonsils out is pretty easy the day of surgery, but that's the only day that's easy. The procedure generally is one that's done on an outpatient basis. The procedure to take the tonsils out as far as surgery time is pretty quick. I'm talking 10 minutes, maybe 15 minutes in the recovery room. Maybe you're there an hour and then you're on your way home. The first day generally isn't so bad whether you're a kid or an adult, but waking up the second day is kind of when it can be pretty miserable. Young children, 3, 4, 5 years old, they recover pretty quickly. They're probably back to a normal diet, feeling pretty good maybe in 5 days, 6 days. For adults, that could take a full week to 10 days before they feel like they're getting pretty close to normal, but even up to 2 weeks before they really feel like they're back to completely normal. That doesn't mean that I tell adults they shouldn't go to work for 2 weeks. For adults, I say, you know, if you can get 7 to 10 days off, take the 10, but you really are going to appreciate 7 days off. And that's mostly because they're going to be taking narcotic pain medications, and most of the time people shouldn't be going to work doing that. Are they snoring loudly? Are they breathing through their mouth all the time? And when they're sleeping, do they have times when they're pausing, when they're supposed to be breathing and they kind of and they hold their breath and you wonder when are they going to breathe, and then a few seconds later they get back to breathing. If any of those three things are happening, it's likely that they have sleep disordered breathing. Kids who have sleep disordered breathing are much more likely to have behavioral problems. The good news is by taking out the tonsils in kids, many times you can get them to sleep like a baby. For adults, just taking out tonsils alone may not be enough. There are some other more advanced procedures that you can do as well, depending on what the anatomy looks like. Oftentimes, adults will end up getting a sleep study, too. In kids, generally speaking, we don't get a sleep study. The history that the parents say of, oh, every night, you know, I'm down the hall and I'm closing my door, I'm closing their door, and I can still hear them snoring, that's pretty much all we need. For kids, oftentimes you don't worry too much about that. You're not gonna talk about diet in kids too much, meaning that they're still growing. It's kind of hard to know, well, are they overweight or are they underweight? Well, in 6 months they could totally change. Obese and overweight adults tend not to do as well, regardless of procedure for their sleep apnea. Oftentimes they may end up on a CPAP machine, kind of a sleeping device that helps them breathe a little better at night. But the key would be lose some weight. And that not only is good for your sleeping, but good for your heart and your blood pressure and cholesterol and that type of thing. Kids get to eat ice cream for a week. I tell adults do the same thing. Stay hydrated. That's the number one thing you can do to feel better afterwards.